Morning, my name's Andy Young, and I am one of the automotive lecturers down at Unitech in Auckland. As you've probably guessed, there's quite a few videos now on my YouTube channel regarding various repairs, diagnostics, and so on cars, motorcycles, and ATVs. On the previous video to this one, we covered the internals of a master cylinder, a tandem master cylinder. That's one with two separate pressure chambers, and we pulled it apart and we talked about all the internals and what can fail and how it's got the two safety features in there. So if one circuit on the car, the brake lines fail, we get a hole, then the other circuit's still going to work. Now most modern cars, sorry that's one, that's terrible. Most modern cars also use a brake booster or a brake servo, we call these in England. In conjunction with the master cylinder, and this device, its job is to increase the brake force applied by the driver through the mechanical mechanism of the brake pedal and the push rod coming from the pedal. So this end here connects to the brake, the top of the brake pedal, and has an input force going that way. And then coming out on this little push rod here should be a multiplication of that force, but still controlled. And that force then goes in there and makes contact with the primary piston of the master cylinder. Now, we're going to look at one of these on the car. There's a couple of things that you need to check when diagnosing whether a brake booster is working correctly or not. And you see this input here. Well, this is the vacuum input. And this on petrol engined cars comes from the intake manifold. The supply of vacuum comes from the engine's intake manifold. But on a diesel engine, they can't do that. So they have to fit usually a vacuum pump. And normally that's mounted on the back of the alternator purely for convenience. So there's some other tests that need to be done on diesels, but we're not going to cover that in this video. So to all intents and purposes, I will assume this is off a petrol car, and this is the vacuum input. Now, not on this one, but on one we've got outside on the vehicle, and they all will have this. They have a one-way valve somewhere between this input pipe and the flexi pipe that runs down to the intake manifold. And what that means is that the vacuum, and that's the air traveling or being extracted from the chamber in here, is going in this direction out of the brake booster towards the intake manifold. And we have a one-way valve which prevents only airflow to occur in that direction, which means if you turn off the engine for whatever reason, we don't then lose all the vacuum that we've stored in the brake booster. That one-way valve closes and it maintains the vacuum, which then means for safety that you've got two, three, maybe four actuations of the brake pedal with servo assistance. After that, we've depleted the vacuum that's stored in here, and you're basically down to non-assisted brakes on your car. The brakes still work, they're just not assisted, so you've got to press a lot harder to get the same braking effect on your vehicle. Now, what is absolutely critical to the adjustments on this system is the distance, the length of this push rod in here. Now, it is adjustable, and I'm going to run through the measurement technique and how to set it up later in this video. But if we have too much clearance between the end of this push rod and the primary piston in the master cylinder, then you're going to get excessive travel of the brake pedal. In addition, you might get brakes where they're not particularly progressive. You put your foot on the brake and all of a sudden, bang, you know, you've got a lot of braking force. As that clearance is taken up, and then it suddenly makes contact with the primary piston. What's A much worse scenario is if there's a negative clearance between this push rod and the primary piston. That means that when we bolt the master cylinder back on to the brake booster, as we tighten up those nuts, this push rod already starts to push the primary piston down into the master cylinder a very small distance, maybe half a mil, maybe quarter of a mil, whatever it is, maybe even a millimeter, maybe 2 mil, depends who's been adjusting it. Now, the problem that that can cause is that, you remember the compensating port that we discussed inside the master cylinder? Well, the main seal of the primary piston sits just behind that, keeping that, or allowing that compensating port to be open when the brakes are not in use. And that allows for thermal expansion of the brake fluid. And as the brake fluid expands, a small volume can leak back and return to the reservoir. Now, if that push rod has been adjusted incorrectly and it's a little bit too long, that compensating port is closed off, which means that as your brakes warm up, and the brakes do warm up as soon as you start to use them, and they can get quite hot, the fluid will still expand, but it's got nowhere to go. It can't return back to the reservoir. Instead, what happens is it starts to push out the pistons on your brake calipers or your wheel cylinders or whatever's in the circuit. And that can cause the brakes to bind on. That's a really bad thing. It can also make bleeding up the brakes very difficult or sometimes impossible. So that's something else to bear in mind. So the adjustment of that push rod is very, very important. So if you're going to change the brake booster on your car, or you're going to change the master cylinder on your car, and okay, they may look identical units, it is important that you check it. If you're using a different brand of master cylinder, or you're fitting a brand new brake booster, then it's absolutely critical again that you adjust, or at least check and make adjustments if required, on that push rod. If you don't, you could potentially have some really big problems trying to sort your brakes out on your vehicle. So if you're not aware of this as being an issue, how on earth would you diagnose it as being a fault? Okay, we're going to go across to the infamous black RAV4, which is now back in the workshop for a complete engine swap. Yes, it's now not running on number 3 cylinder, so that's a whole new issue, and no doubt a catalogue of videos that are going to come from that vehicle now. But we're going to go across and we're going to have a look at the brake booster's location on the vehicle. We're going to trace that vacuum pipe and we're going to find the one-way valve. We're going to take it off the car and we're going to test it. Because if that fails, then you're not going to get those 2 or 3 actuations. And also, if the engine is revving high and the throttle valve, the butterfly valve, is open, we have no vacuum, which means that your brakes on the vehicle are not going to be assisted when you're at full throttle or above 3/4 throttle, really. Now, you may say to yourself, well, hang on a minute, I'm not going to use the brakes while I'm on the throttle. No, you're not, so you're probably never going to notice. But what you will notice is as soon as you turn the engine off, the pedal will go immediately hard and you'll have no brakes. And if the engine were to stall on the motorway, or to stall at all, maybe going down a hill, and you instantly lost brake assistance, to some drivers, that might be a problem. So as a mechanic, we need to be able to test that one-way valve, and it's very, very simple to test. Okay, so we're going to head over to the vehicle, and we'll go and locate the brake booster. Okay, so you can see clearly we've got the master cylinder reservoir here, we've got the master cylinder sitting underneath, and of course it's bolted directly onto a brake booster. Now this brake booster is slightly larger in diameter than the other one, which means it's going to be slightly more powerful, more surface area on the diaphragm. And you can see here, this is the vacuum pipes. It's coming off, it's usually the largest one that comes off the intake manifold on the engine. And you can see it runs very clearly, very short one on this particular vehicle, that runs straight to the brake booster. Now that one-way valve is actually here. On some brake boosters,
they're actually integral to the pipe. They're actually inside. The manufacturer pushes them down the pipe, so you won't actually spot them. But if you crush the pipe with your fingers, you can usually feel a hard lump somewhere down there, and that's where it's located. So they, rest assured, they do have them. It's just that they're not obvious where they are. Okay, so I'm going to just undo that bolt down there to, well, I flex it back actually, I'll just flex that tine back there, look, and we're going to just pull that unit out, pull that valve out, remove this clip so we isolate the valve, take it off the pipe, and take it over to the bench, and we'll bench test that one-way valve to make sure it's working properly. Right, so we'll just remove that clip first of all, we'll just slide it down the pipe. Now we should be able to just pull that unit. Now you can hear that hissing noise. That means that there is vacuum inside the actual brake booster. That's because we've just started the engine to move the vehicle, and that vacuum should stay there. There we go. So the vacuum's gone. There's your one-way valve. Just going to remove that from there. And you can see now there's a valve assembly inside there. And we're going to take it over to the bench, and we're going to check that on the bench to make sure it's working properly. The fact that we had vacuum would indicate that this is operating correctly. But we'll go and bench test it just so you know how to do that as well. And it's always a good idea if you're replacing these, and especially if you've got a second-hand one, to test it before you fit it. Otherwise, you could be adding more problems to your vehicle.
Right, so one of the tools that we can use to check the operation of a vacuum valve is a vacuum pump, and it's always good just to check that your vacuum pump's working correctly. This one is probably about, golly, 15 years old, made by Snap-on, and well, it didn't work. Pulled it out of the box, didn't work. Just pulled it apart, cleaned it up, greased the piston inside, and now we have vacuum pump. Yes! So another one of my expensive tools that I bought years and years ago, still works. Great stuff. Okay, so what we need to do is attach that vacuum pump onto the end of that valve. Now, sure, there's a really easy way of testing these, and not everybody's got one of these vacuum pumps, but we do have a source of vacuum, and that's you. Now, as mechanics, we do tend to get a bit oily and stuff, and we taste petrol and things like that. So to test this, easy way and the quick way, and we pretty much know already that it works fine because of the booster was holding vacuum earlier on, is if we put that in our mouth, and I know health and safety is going to go ballistic over this, so if you're working for somebody and they're paying you to do this, probably not a good idea. But if it's on your own car and you're happy to take the risk, it's not a problem. Okay, so you get the vacuum pump and you hear the hissing noise. That's great. That means we've got airflow from here going in through the valve and out through the output here, and that's what heads off down to the intake manifold and gets burnt as air by the engine. If you blow the other way and you can't hear any hissing noise and you can't feel your cheeks going in, so it's not losing pressure, and you've got millions of little sensors in there, so it's pretty cool, then you know that it's sealing properly, and that's a pass. Now, with the vacuum pump, you can only test in one direction, and we're going to have to come up with a genius plan, find a larger bit of pipe that's going to adapt onto there, and then you can use the pump. Now, in all honesty, I don't really have time for that this morning. I've got lots and lots of videos to get done. So if you want to use a vacuum pump, that's what you need to do. Find the right size pipe, and usually inside the box you've got lots of different adapters and bits and pieces, which is very useful for that kind of stuff. But if you just want to check it real quick, then that's a pass, and then you got to blow it and it should remain sealed, and that prevents airflow going in the other direction. So I'm very, very happy with that. So that's going to go back on the car. So next we're going to go out to the vehicle. I'm going to refit this, and I'm going to show you how to test a brake booster on car. So you can jump in your own car. If you think you've got a brake booster or a brake servo fault, I'll show you a really simple and quick way of how to test it on the vehicle. And then once all that's done, we'll come back into the workshop and I'm going to show you how to set the distance of that push rod And there's a little bit of measuring going on, and you need obviously your master cylinder and your brake booster together to be able to set that adjustment. And the actual specification does vary from car manufacturer to car manufacturer, and brake booster, you know, car model to car model. So you're going to have to find the workshop manual to get this specification. And it's probably only the car manufacturer's own workshop manual that will have information like this in it. Haynes manual? I don't think so. I've never read it in there. So that sort of level, home maintenance kind of manual, I don't think it covers it. But hey, I could be wrong. All you can do is find out. Right, back to the car. Let's go and refit this and check the brake booster's operation. Okay, so I've refitted the one-way valve back onto the brake booster, put the pipe on. That's all back to as it should be. And I'm just going to show you a really quick way of testing the operation of your brake booster whilst it's still on the vehicle. What you need to do is start up the engine, and this is a poorly engine. Three cylinders. It's supposed to have four, by the way. Right. The first step is to turn the engine off. We'll take the key out. So what we've done there is we've filled the brake booster, and I'll explain which chamber's which, but we've filled the forward chamber of the brake booster. In fact, we've filled both chambers. Yes, we've... So, shut up. Okay, so I've refitted the one-way valve back onto the brake booster, put the pipe on. That's all back to as it should be. And I'm just going to show you a really quick way of testing the operation of your brake booster whilst it's still on the vehicle. What you need to do is start up the engine, and this is a poorly engine. Ooh, three cylinders. It's supposed to have four, by the way. The first step is to turn the engine off. So we'll take the key out. So step one is we've started the engine. That's created vacuum. I had the engine at idle, so we get maximum vacuum in the intake manifold, and that vacuum is applied to both sides of the diaphragm, and that will become clear shortly, both sides of the diaphragm inside the brake booster. Now what I need to do now is pump the brake pedal a few times, and you'll feel it go hard. That's when all the assistance has gone, i.e. we've depleted the vacuum that's inside the brake booster. Okay, so you just press the brake pedal down and keep pressing it. Oh, there we go, until it gets really hard. Now, you can press it a fair few times if you want, just to be sure. Doesn't make any difference. Usually three or four is enough. And then whilst holding the brake down, we start the engine again. And what should happen is the pedal should sink further. There you go. So you saw my foot move, drop down about an inch. Okay, so you can see when I had the camera down at the pedals, that once the engine started, the brake pedal sank down about an inch. And that tells us that the assistance that's been provided by the booster is now there again. It's the brakes have been assisted, the vacuum has been reapplied to the diaphragm, and down goes the pedal. So as regards a quick and easy on-car test, and this is part of what we call a warrant of fitness test here in New Zealand, and they would also do this during an MOT. The tester would do that to make sure that everything's working correctly. Is it an MOT fail if it's not? Well, I don't know. It should be, I suppose, because it does, you know, you can drive the car without brake assistance. The brakes haven't failed. But I think it would be a hazard, actually, for most drivers if all of a sudden they lost brake assistance whilst they're driving along. They're going to panic, and that could cause an accident. So yes, not a very good idea. Okay, so that's how to do an on-car booster, brake booster or brake servo test. Very simple, and you can actually do it within a few seconds. It's not hard at all. When I always get my students in one of their exams, they have to actually make a step-by-step procedure of how to test a brake booster on car, because it's a pretty common fault, you know, they can go wrong. Okay, so we're going to head back into the workshop now,
and I'm going to talk a bit more about how the brake booster actually works inside.
Okay, so we've done the test of the one-way valve. We've done an on-car test of the brake booster. What I haven't I've also discussed where the vacuum supply comes from on a petrol engine and a diesel engine. What we haven't done is really discuss what's inside the brake booster. Now, something to bear in mind is they're not classed as a serviceable item. Yes, really, really old ones. You were able to take them apart. Some of them, not very many, but some of them could be disassembled. You can't buy parts for them. All the modern ones cannot be taken apart. They're a sealed unit. So if it fails that test on the car, then you've got to unbolt it as a unit, go and get another one that looks about the same. Well, actually looks exactly the same. Refit it, adjust the push rod, and then away you go. So I want to, before we start doing the push rod measurement, I want to very quickly give you an explanation on what's actually happening inside the brake booster. Now, I'm going to give you an overview. It is a little bit more complicated than what I'm going to tell you, but the principle is accurate. The way that it does it is there's a combination of valves inside. I'm not going to get into that. I just want you to understand or have an idea of what's happening inside that brake booster. I brought an infamous piece of cardboard and my marker pen. So let's have a look. Okay, so inside the brake booster, and if I just draw the casing first of all, I'm not the greatest at drawing stuff, so please forgive me. And we're not going to draw all the seals and stuff. Okay, the output push rod there, look. That comes down, comes around like this. Now, we have vacuum. Now, that's the way the arrow should be because that's the way that the air is being evacuated when the engine's running. We've got an input here. That's the driver's pedal force. And here, we've got the force to the primary piston. Okay. Now, in the middle, we've got a diaphragm. And when the brakes are not in use, we have vacuum on both sides of the diaphragm. Let's call it chamber A and chamber B. So chamber A always has vacuum, and that one-way valve, don't forget, is located here, so air can only flow in that direction. Chamber B, when we're not using the brakes, has exactly the same vacuum, and there is in the center here, let's just put little blocks to represent it, there is a valve block, okay, inside here. What that does is it opens a port and allows vacuum to flow, or it basically extracts atmospheric pressure from this side. So it allows these two chambers to be linked, so we have equal vacuum both sides, which means that the diaphragm doesn't move. There is no force provided, and all the push rods remain stationary. As we press the brake pedal, or the driver does, and don't forget, it's progressive, you know, we can apply the brake pedal a little bit or a lot. We apply the brake pedal, and as soon as we apply the brake pedal, it closes the vacuum valve. It closes the link between these two chambers. And then, once it's done that, it allows air pressure, atmospheric pressure, to flow inside or into chamber B. Now, as soon as that happens, we start to get a pressure differential. And that causes the diaphragm to move towards the vacuum. We've got more pressure here than we have here. So there's a pressure differential. This is a vacuum. This isn't as much of a vacuum to start off with. So the diaphragm moves across, and with it, it takes the push rod to the master cylinder. The more we press the brake pedal, the more air is allowed to enter this chamber. If we press the brake pedal and then stop and hold the position of the brake pedal, then no more air is allowed to enter chamber B. And essentially, the force that's applied becomes constant. It doesn't change anymore. It just holds that additional force to help us apply the brakes. If we relax the brake pedal slightly, then it opens up momentarily the vacuum port, and it allows some of this air pressure in chamber B to be extracted back to the intake manifold, therefore reducing the amount of force applied to the master cylinder. If we then reapply the brake pedal again, just a bit more, then it's going to close, that vacuum port will then be closed. It will then allow some more air to go into chamber B, and then the force increases again. What's inside here, the actual valve body, the way it works, I'm not concerned about on this particular video. I want you to understand the principle of how a brake booster is able to provide additional braking force. And that's done by controlling, modulating, the amount of vacuum, stroke, air pressure in chamber B. And it's the difference between the two pressures, between A and B, that creates more or less force. If we have equal vacuum, no force. If we have full atmospheric pressure, so that's basically like an emergency stop, we've slammed our foot on the brake pedal, and this valve has been opened fully, we've got full atmospheric pressure being applied to B, we've got maximum pressure differential. Plus, don't forget the driver's pedal force, he's stamping on the brake pedal as well, we're going to be getting maximum force being applied to the master cylinder. Now, when we've finished braking, let's say we've pulled up at the traffic lights, the lights have gone from red to green, we're now setting off, we take our foot off the brake pedal, then what will happen is the atmospheric port inside this valve body will close and the vacuum port will fully open, and it will then return to having equal vacuum in A and B. All the air in chamber B will be extracted through the vacuum port and out to the intake manifold via chamber A. So we're going to have equal vacuum both chambers, and it returns back to the at rest position, brakes not applied, no assistance provided. Now, when we do the test on car, we've got, initially, we've started the engine, a vacuum has been created in the intake manifold, and we have high vacuum in both chambers. We turn off the engine. Still got vacuum in both chambers. We pump the brake pedal, and what that does is it uses up all the vacuum in chamber A, the vacuum that's been stored via the one-way valve, all the vacuum is dissipated and there is no brake assistance. Pedal goes hard. We then keep our foot on the brake pedal, start the engine, and then we get vacuum generated by the intake manifold or at the intake manifold. That vacuum is applied to chamber A, and then as that vacuum builds up, the pressure differential, we've got atmospheric pressure in B, we've got large vacuum developing in chamber A because the engine's now started to run, and then we're going to start to get maximum force being applied back to the master cylinder. And of course, as that to apply that force, this push rod must move. It moves with the diaphragm, and that allows the brake pedal push rod to sink down. Right, the pedal sinks slightly, and that's the indication that everything's working correctly. Okay, so you see my little basic diagram. I've not covered how the actual design and the way that the vacuum port works between the two chambers. I've not covered exactly where the atmospheric valve is located. What I have done is cover the theory behind how the additional braking force is generated. And for example, if we had a rupture in the diaphragm, now the diaphragm is a wearing component, then of course we're going to get constant leakage between the two chambers all the time, which means that either the whole thing's not going to provide any force, or if it's a tiny pinhole, then we're going to get much reduced force. The other thing to bear in mind is we may also, when we press the brakes and open the atmospheric port and there's a hole in the diaphragm, that airflow is going to go through all the way through to the intake manifold. And we're going to notice the engine revs pick up because the mixture's going lean. Take the foot off the brake pedal, that valve closes and the mixture returns to what it should be and the engine idles correctly. Press the brake again and the engine revs suddenly pick up slightly. That's another indication that there's an internal fault somewhere inside the brake booster. Can we fix it? No, you can't fix the unit. You throw it away and put a new one on. I'll go and find a second helm one. So diagnostics. If you've got an engine that's not running correctly at idle whenever you press the brake pedal, weird, then it could be your brake booster. All that's left now to do is to cover how to adjust the output push rod from the brake booster, which makes contact with the primary piston of the master cylinder. So we're going to do that now. I'm going to come up with a specification of 0.5 of a millimeter. That's the gap that there should be. Okay, all right. Specifications should be not a fixed number. There should be a range. So let's give ourselves a specification of 0.25. Let's write that down on the sheet. 0.25 to 0.75 millimeters. I have no idea what the specification is for a Nissan Patrol. I have no idea what the measurement is or the setting is, the clearance is on this particular brake booster. So we'll measure to see what it is, and then we'll decide how much we've got to change it by. We'll make some changes, we'll adjust it, and then we'll re-measure it and we'll be all good. Okay, it's easy. To do this, the tools that you're going to need ideally is a vernier caliper and a thick steel ruler would be quite useful as well. Okay, so we're going to get our vernier calipers, and I find these digital ones really, really easy to use. Anyone can use these. Very simple and quick and easy, and that's what life's all about. So we need to take two sets of measurements. One set from the master cylinder and one set from the brake booster. We'll do the brake booster first because that's by far the easiest. And you can see on the brake booster, this is the push rod here, look, sticking out. And if I turn it to one side, you can see that it protrudes from this reference surface here. This is the mating surface where the master cylinder bolts to. So the equivalent surface on the master cylinder is that surface there, okay? And to all intents and purposes, we can class that as the same plane. And that's our reference point. So first of all, we're going to take a measurement of how far that push rod is protruding from or above this reference point surface. Very simple. Now, because there's such a huge gap, we're going to need to use a straight edge. And this is quite a thick ruler. It doesn't really give much, so we can use that quite easily. And it's going to sit on the reference surface. And this ruler is 1.8 millimeters thick. We can just double check that. There you go, look. 1.81 millimeters thick. Okay, hopefully you saw that. Now, to measure the additional distance, and we'll add the thickness of the ruler later on, we just pop that on there, run that down until it touches, and we've got 7.62 millimeters plus the 1.81. Okay, so we had 7.62 measurement on the verniers plus the 1.81 mil thickness of the ruler gives us a total of 9.43 millimeters of protrusion of that push rod from the reference surface. That's the surface, the plane that the master cylinder the flange on the cylinder actually sits on. The next measurement now is going to be, or the next set of measurements is from the master cylinder itself. Now we have to do it slightly more complicated on there because on the master cylinder, it's the hole down there. On the primary piston, it has a drilling and the push rod sits down that drilling. Now we need to know, and okay, as a rough guide, we could do that with our finger and thumbnail, sit it on the end of there, and you could tell that, okay, it's somewhere around about that point there, look. But that's a bit inaccurate, and what we need to do is real accurate stuff for this. It's really critical, is the adjustment on these. So the first thing we're going to need to do is take a measurement from the bottom of that hole, that drilling, and it is actually rounded to match the end of the pushrod, okay, to this surface here. And then we'll take a second measurement from this surface down to the datum surface here, the actual mounting surface of the mast cylinder. And we can deduct the two, and that will give us the distance. So, let's crack on. Okay, so again, we're going to use our trusty ruler. But this time, because the ruler is sitting on top, to get an accurate distance onto this surface here, we're going to need to deduct the thickness of the ruler this time around. So pop that down there. I've already zeroed it. I'll just run it down till it touches the ruler. And the reading we've got is 27.8. Now the ruler's 1.8, near as damn it. So that gives us a reading of 26 millimeters. Now we then need to deduct the distance from this plane down to this plane, the mounting surface. And again, we're gonna have to use the ruler. There we go. So stick that on there and just run that down, and we get 18.86. Now we need to deduct off that thickness of the ruler, so that's going to be 17.06. Okay, so on the master cylinder then, from the end here, down the tube, down the drilling at the end of the primary piston, we got exactly 26 millimeters. And then from that plane down to the mating surface, we got just over 17, so 17.06. And we minus those two and we get 8.94. There's something going on here. So 8.94, which is almost 9, and we've got a protrusion of the push rod of 9.43. That means that when we assemble this onto the brake booster, the primary piston, well, the push rod is making contact with the primary piston and pushing it down the bore by about half a mil, which is exactly the problem I was talking about at the start of this video, where the main L-type seal on the primary piston is going to be moving half a mil, and that could easily be enough to close off that compensating port. There should be either no clearance, zero distance, or a very small distance, maybe half a mil, quarter of a mil, something like that. So, believe it or not, this at some point in the past has been has had a mast cylinder swapped out. This actually doesn't look old enough. You know, that vehicle was 22 years old when this came off, and we've had it now for two more years, so 24 years old. This doesn't look like a 24-year-old master cylinder, which tells me that it's been replaced. Now, if it's been replaced, then the distances could be a little bit different on the new one to the old one, and the previous person has not adjusted the push rod on the brake booster to match the new master cylinder. So this vehicle potentially could have had problems with its brakes. I only drove it for a short time before we stripped it down, so didn't seem to have too many issues, but we only drove a short distance. Maybe on a particularly hot day or using the brakes for a lot would have caused an issue. So I gave a fictitious specification initially of between 0.25 and 0.75 mil. clearance. And at the moment, we've got 0.5, near as damn it, negative clearance, which we shouldn't have. So to, we need to, if we adjust that push rod and make it 1 millimeter shorter in length protruding from the mating surface, then that will give us 0.5 mil clearance. And 0.5 mil clearance is exactly bang in the spec that I came up with at the start. So now I'm going to show you how to adjust the length of that push rod. Now you'll notice that there's some threads, and essentially this domed piece here is a nut on the end of those threads. And underneath there's some splines. Now we can use some long nose pliers to hold the actual push rod itself stationary whilst we screw down, because we're going to be making this a bit shorter. We can screw that nut down. Obviously there's a limit to how much adjustment's available, but we need to reduce that by 1 mil. Right, so it's a bit of hit and miss. We'll adjust it a bit, remeasure it, and then we'll see where we need to go from there. Okay, so I've got to screw it. It's normally a right hand thread, so we'll just turn it the normal way. Hopefully that push rod's gonna remain locked. Do as it's told. No, it's not. The manufacturers will have a special tool for this that will slide over those splines and hold it still. We don't have one of those, so we'll try some vice grips. There we go. My best ones are on that, on the Ford laser at the moment. Okay. So let's have another go. Let's see if we can get that to turn. There we go. It is real tight on the threads because there's no lock nut on there. So they've designed it to be tight on the threads, so that there's no way it can move under normal operation. Okay, so I've turned it about one full turn. Right. Definitely looks shorter to me. Okay. So now we've got, that's more like it, 6.87 plus 1.8, 7.87, 8.6-ish. So we still need to do some more yet. So we've near as damn it moved that whole push rod exactly 1 millimetre shorter, made it 1 millimetre shorter, so there's on the actual top of the push rod there, look, you can see that. That's now protruding near as damn it 1 millimetre less. We've gone from 0.5 mil negative clearance, so it was adjusted wrongly, to about 0.5 mil clearance. And the specification was 0.25 to 0.75 of a millimetre. That now is correct. We can refit the master cylinder and put it back on the vehicle, and it should all work properly. Okay. Okay, so there you go. We've covered quite a bit on this video, actually. It's going to end up being a lot longer than I thought. Where do we start? Well, we covered how to test the one-way valve on the vacuum supply pipe. We covered how to do an on-vehicle test of a brake booster. We discussed how the brake booster actually operates internally due to pressure differential. One side of the diaphragm has vacuum, the other side has atmospheric pressure, and that gives us maximum assistance. We didn't really discuss as to why most vehicles have brake boosters these days. And that's to do with the fact that originally, back in the 70s and 80s, and actually on some particular cars, even the early 90s, they had drum brakes all round. Now, drum brakes, some of the shoes are self-energizing, which means that when the drum brake is applied, the shoe is drawn like a wedge against the inside of the brake drum. And that in itself gives us some free extra effort in the braking. When you go on to disc brakes, even though they're much better at cooling and all that kind of stuff and easy to maintain and things, and ultimately a lot more powerful, or can be with the right braking force, they are not self-energizing at all. They require a much larger clamping force between the brake pads and the brake disc. And the only way for us to get that is to have much higher brake fluid pressures in the hydraulic circuit. Now, for the driver alone to achieve that, they would have to have a very long brake pedal, basically, and there'd be heaps of travel. So manufacturers had to come up with a way of multiplying the braking force that the driver applies. And essentially, don't forget, on more modern vehicles, people want the car to be easier to drive, to require less effort to drive around. So that's why we got power steering, for example. So there you go. Having a brake booster on your vehicle makes it much, much easier to drive. They're on the vehicles these days because of the disc brakes are more popular. And if your vehicle's got disc brakes all round, then without a brake booster, you'd find it very, very hard to stop the vehicle. Okay, well, I hope you found this helpful. Doing the pushrod clearance adjustment is really important. A lot of mechanics do not realize this, and given by what we've seen today on the one that came off a Nissan Patrol a couple of years ago, whoever changed that master cylinder just took the old one off and put the new one on. They made no adjustments whatsoever to the length of the pushrod. And that's often the case. And to be honest with you, before I started teaching and running my own fleet of four-wheel drives in the UK, I never adjusted the pushrod length, ever. And looking back, we did have brake problems that I couldn't work out. And that could well have been down to the fact that the pushrod was actually protruding too far out of the housing of the booster and causing the brakes, once they warmed up, to bind on. And we had problems bleeding brakes up sometimes as well, and maybe that was one of the reasons. Who knows? I know now, and whenever I change a master cylinder, I always check the brake pushrod, the booster length, just to be on the safe side. Do I find out the specs? Not always, I agree, but I make damn sure we don't have a negative clearance. That's the critical thing. Having a clearance is obviously important, but some boosters have zero. I've seen that on the specs before. It's 0 to 0.1 of a millimetre, for example. But you mustn't ever have a negative clearance. That would be wrong, I'm sure. Okay, so there you go. Job done. Too much rambling. My name's Andy Young. I am one of the automotive lecturers down at Unitech in Auckland, New Zealand. And I produce these videos primarily for my students. This week they're going to be doing all about brake boosters, testing them and doing this pushrod measurement. And I hope that they and you have found this video helpful. Thanks for watching. Cheers. Over and out.